I think it's time we ask ourselves if we still know the freedoms that were intended for us by the Founding Fathers. Whether we believe in our capacity for self-government or whether we abandon the American Revolution and confess that a little intellectual elite in a far distant capital can plan our lives for us better than we can plan them ourselves. If we lose freedom here, there's no place to escape to. This is the last stand on earth.
It's the Libertopian Podcast, and I'm Chad Mitchell, your host. It's only been 2 days since I've been on, and the news is just off the charts, and so I had to come on and break it down. Rand Paul has announced that he will be endorsing Mitt Romney for the Republican nomination for president, essentially pulling his support for his father, Congressman Ron Paul. And also, Peter Schiff, one of my favorite financial and liberty personalities, testified before Congress yesterday. I will have sound on that shortly, and we'll break that down and talk about it. I heard some of it earlier, and the questions that he was asked and the assertions made by the Congress women and men were just so outrageous. I just have to break down and comment and debunk what they have said to Peter Schiff on the Congressional House floor. Going back to Rand Paul, though, this is causing a break in the liberty movement, and it's not something that needs to happen. And last night on Sean Hannity's show, Rand Paul came out, obviously, and endorsed Mitt Romney. And I expected it. I don't know what these people in the Ron Paul movement expected from Rand Paul. 2 weeks ago, you could pull up clips of him on the internet on Peter Schiff's show, on he's been on many shows. I can't remember the other show that I heard him on, but he's been on many shows. And in every single interview that he's given, they've asked him, you know, if Ron Paul doesn't get the nomination, or it looks like he's not going to get the nomination, will you endorse the eventual nominee for the Republican, or the eventual Republican nominee for the presidency of the United States of America? And Rand Paul has said each and every time that I will support the Republican nominee, whoever that may be. So I knew this was coming. I did not realize that so many Ron Paul supporters were delusional in their understanding that Rand Paul was going to toe the party line when it came to the Republican nomination and not go third party and support, you know, Gary Johnson for the Libertarian ticket. I mean, what did you expect him to do? That's my question. What did the Liberty Movement expect Rand Paul to do? And it's frustrating me to see all of the hatred towards Rand. Let me explain something. Rand Paul has scored the highest rating that any U.S. senator has scored, I'm not sure ever, but in the last edition anyway, he was the highest ranked senator on the John Birch Society's Congressional Freedom Index. That actually points towards his voting record. So all of these people who are saying that Rand Paul has compromised, that he has sold out the liberty movement, you are mistaken. You do not understand the game plan that is being played here. I saw it months ago. I saw it a year ago. Rand Paul is a Trojan horse. He is deceiving conservatives and Republicans who are establishment in nature. He is not deceiving the liberty movement. I almost said libertarian movement. Libertarian, liberty, constitutional, whatever you want to call it. He is not deceiving you, okay? He is using slick political language, and he is pulling, you know, from the Art of War 101, he is doing exactly what he should be doing in infiltrating into the Republican Party. And he is deceiving them. He is not deceiving you. Those people do not understand principles. They do not care necessarily what Rand Paul's voting record is within the Republican Party. What they care about is how he presents himself to other Republicans. If he supports certain Republican candidates, that's what they care about. And so Rand Paul is setting himself up for either a 2016 run for president or a 2020 run for president, maybe even a VP run along with Mitt Romney. And he is setting himself up to be palatable to not only the Liberty Movement, but also conservatives and Republicans alike, moderate Republicans even as well, would go for Rand Paul, because his rhetoric that he is using is not as heated. Ron Paul had a specific goal in mind. It was never a political goal. It was always a goal about educating and trying to grow the Liberty Movement. Rand Paul's goal is not the same. So don't be mistaken by the rhetoric that he's using or the endorsement that he has given to Mitt Romney, because it is not traitorous in nature. I'm trying to think of a word, and this is a word that everyone seems to be calling or using against Rand Paul, is the word traitor. He is not a traitor to the Liberty Movement. Look at his voting record. He is not a foreign policy hawk. Look at his voting record. In fact, on Hannity's show last night, he even talked about that whenever he was speaking with Mitt Romney, he was trying to get Mitt Romney to come towards us. He was trying to get Mitt Romney to see that we need to restore the power to declare war back in the hands of Congress. Rand Paul is trying to change the system from within. This is not the time to abandon him and say, just because you aren't a radical libertarian and every bit of your rhetoric is anti-establishment, anti-Republican, anti-Democrat, you know, that's good from an educational standpoint, but when it comes to actually getting things done politically, it has been the Achilles heel of the Liberty Movement for the longest time. There are times when politics are needed and times when education is needed. And politics is the art of the possible. It is sometimes about prudence, as Rand Paul has shown many times. And it doesn't mean that you compromise on core principles. Rand Paul has shown that you can be politically palatable, politically electable, while maintaining high integrity and not compromising on your principles. So all of this hoopla coming from the Ron Paul camp and the Ron Paul supporters around it, in my opinion, it's unneeded. It's unnecessary. You're going to splinter the Liberty Movement in a time when we could use Rand Paul as a Trojan horse to get someone who truly in his heart is for the Liberty Movement into high positions of power. That is what we need. We don't just need Rand Paul. We need this to occur on every single level of government, from the local level to the state level. And you can possibly be a little bit more radical with the candidates as far as the rhetoric that they're using on the local level and the state level, because you have a higher chance of getting those types of people elected into positions of power. But when it comes to the presidency of the United States, the vice president, senators, you have to be careful with the rhetoric that you are using, especially when the American people are not woken up at this point. They haven't woken up. It is our job as liberty activists to continue to wake up the American people. It is our job to do that. It is not Rand Paul's job to do that. It is Rand Paul is already woken up, okay? Rand Paul is there because liberty activists were able to get him in. He is there as a Trojan horse, so to speak. And I guarantee you that Rand Paul and Ron Paul have sat down together, and they have discussed this. They know what they're doing, okay? They know what they're doing. I guarantee it, because I know Rand Paul's opinions before he got elected were more radical. And so as he was running for senator, if you notice, he toned down a lot of the rhetoric. As he's been a senator, he's toned down a lot of the rhetoric. It's been more generic Republican talking points as far as what he said. His voting record has not been quite that way, though. His voting record has been more pro-liberty. More pro-liberty than any senator on the floor, including some very pro-liberty senators. I mean, I think Mike Lee and Jim DeMint are pro-liberty to some degree. I mean, they really are. And Rand Paul really beat them out hands down. So I think that all of this hatred and pulling of the support away from Rand Paul is really misplaced. It really is. And the Liberty Movement needs to come together right now more than ever, stand behind Rand Paul. I'm not saying you have to support Mitt Romney. I'm not going to support Mitt Romney. Even if Mitt Romney were to get to make Rand Paul his VP, I'm still not going to support Mitt Romney, because I would still be voting for Mitt Romney. But whether or not Mitt Romney wins the presidential election, as Rand Paul being his VP or not, the political goal being achieved is the same. The political goal of Rand Paul being the vice presidential nominee is still achieved. And so you don't have to support Mitt Romney, but understand the politics that are being played here and understand what Rand Paul's true goals are at this point. And don't get sidetracked by the demagoguery. See, this is demagoguery coming out of the Liberty camp. This should not be coming out of the Liberty camp. We need to understand what's politically possible and what's not. You can devise up these utopian schemes in your head all you want, but the reality is We the utopian ideas and the pure liberty concepts are great to wake people up. They are not great when you're trying to apply them politically to an unwoken mass of the public. The mass of the public has not woken up. The mass of the public are they want the Republican talking points, and they want whoever's going to deliver those talking points to them the best way. And Rand Paul, even though he is a liberty candidate, if he can use those talking points to his advantage to get support from people who in reality would not support him if he were to come out brashly and say exactly what he thinks, then so be it. We've got a man on the inside. Let's not lose it here by trying to be complete purist on not just the ends, but also the means. You know, we're being purist on the fact that we want you to vote liberty, but we also want you to speak liberty at all times. And if at any point in time you start to recite Republican talking points, then we're going to pull support from you. We're not going to be able to do that at this point. We're still too large of a minority when it comes to the political populace in general. We have to wake the public up, but in the meantime, we need to stick Trojan horses all throughout the system. Rand Paul is the biggest Trojan horse of all. Again, Liberty Movement, he is not deceiving you. He is deceiving the Republican establishment. And I will be right back with those Peter Schiff clips and continue on with this podcast. This is Chad Mitchell with the Libertopian Podcast. I am back, and I wasn't able to find those Peter Schiff videos yet. I'm sure they'll be on the internet shortly, and when they are, I will be here to comment on them. In the meantime, Ben Bernanke had to testify before Congress yesterday regarding the current economic recovery, or lack thereof, and Jim DeMint had an interesting question for the Federal Reserve Chairman regarding artificially low interest rates and how that is allowing the federal government to overborrow and overspend. Let's have a listen to what the chairman had to say in regards to that.
If we were to raise interest rates by a full percentage point, and ignoring the fact that most debt is of longer duration and would not reprice, that would still only raise the annual deficit by something over $100 billion. So,
which is $1 trillion over 10 years. I mean, that's real money.
No, $1 trillion a year is what I'm saying, is what the current deficit is.
Right, but is the interest cost on that, if it would be $100 billion a year, we're talking of a trillion over 10 years. I mean, we are talking real money.
Trillion there, trillion here? yes, sir.
You know, it's really to the point to where I don't even think that Ben Bernanke takes these congressional hearings very seriously. I mean, did you hear that? How he just laughed? Oh, $1 trillion here, $1 trillion there. I mean, the reality is he's really just smooth talking these congressmen because they a lot of them are not is economically literate, and they think that the Federal Reserve chairman is smarter than they are, and so they don't ask all, you know, they don't always ask the right questions. But one of the things that he said here that I take issue with, well, it's actually two things he said. The first thing was the assumption that interest rates will only go up to 2%. I mean, that is still an artificially low interest rate for this market. This market really needs higher interest rates. We need to rebuild our savings in this country. We need to rebuild savings so we can rebuild capital and the capital structure and be able to start producing things again in this country. So, you know, he makes a false assumption there, but then he also makes another false assumption that, well, it's not really a false assumption, but he says basically that most of the treasuries that are out there are long-term treasuries and that they can't be repriced, even if interest rates go up. Well, number one, most of the treasuries that our creditors are buying are not long-term treasuries. They're short-term treasuries. The only people buying long-term treasuries really is the Federal Reserve itself, right? So that's what he means there. But the reality is our creditors are really the people that matter here. I mean, you can technically write off the Federal Reserve debt because it's just debt on paper. You know, we basically just inflated it into existence. Our creditors, we really owe them some obligation here. Now, I really think that they should take a haircut as it pertains to the investment that they made into the United States Treasury market. I think that it was a bad investment, and they're going to have to take a haircut because we can't pay them, especially when interest rates decide to go up. And they're not going to want to buy the new debt. They're not going to want to buy and finance our deficits when interest rates go up. So that's going to force us to cut spending, essentially. But the short-term treasury bills, I believe, you know, on the debt that we currently have, if interest rates go up, you know, they're going to sell those treasuries into the marketplace and liquidate those treasuries out of existence. And that's going to hurt the U.S. That's going to hurt our ability to continue to borrow at, you know, lower interest rates. We're going to have to borrow at higher interest rates. And so it doesn't necessarily matter. At some point in time, we're going to have to face this economic reality. And Ben Bernanke, you know, with his 2%, two percent interest rates, I mean, give me a break. You know, the reality is we'll be lucky if we don't see 20% interest rates. You know, you cannot maintain these artificially low interest rates forever. And when the swing back up to high interest rates goes into effect, it's going to be that much more damaging to try to liquidate all this malinvestment in the economy and rebuild the capital structure and have some real capital instead of this fake fiat money capital that he's injecting into the economy. Let's continue listening here.
No, I agree with that. But what I'm saying is that the situation is the deficits are so large, particularly going out over the next few years, irrespective of the level of interest rates, that I would think that Congress would have plenty of motivation to try to address that, and that, you know, whether or not the interest rates are currently 1.5% for 10 years or 2.5% just doesn't make that much difference.
I want to respect the chairman's time, but just one other point. My concern now is we're equating pro-growth economic policies with more government spending, and our president is talking about that to the Europeans. Austerity is bad. And on one hand, you're telling us this debt is creating a potential huge crisis, yet you're telling us we need to keep spending with more debt. What is the real signal here?
Let me just jump in here real quick and comment on Jim DeMint's question to Ben Bernanke there. That's just such an excellent question. It's just filled with common sense and logic about, on one hand, the president saying that more government spending creates job growth. On the other hand, you're saying that the potential, this deficit and debt building that we're doing has the potential for a catastrophe later on. So what's the real answer here, right? So I'm not sure. I actually haven't listened to this last part, so I'm not sure what Ben Bernanke is going to say. But the reality is it's this whole dual mandate situation with the Federal Reserve and how they're expected to, you know, manage inflation, keep inflation low, yet also build the economy and, you know, basically stimulate growth and try to maintain full employment, which we've shown in the late 1970s that it doesn't work, right? We had stagflation. You know, you had high inflation, low unemployment, or low employment, I should say, not low unemployment, but low employment. We had high unemployment then. So The reality is you cannot facilitate economic growth through money printing. You cannot inflate your way to prosperity. You need real savings, real capital investment, and a capital structure that works, that's not riddled with malinvestment. You have to have it. You have to have it. You have to have it. You will not build the economy any other way. You will just simply inflate bubbles. And yes, there'll be people who get employed through those bubbles, possibly. But then when the economy, you know, liquidates the malinvestment, they'll lose their job anyway. You have to have real growth here. And so let's go back to Ben Bernanke and see what idiotic thing he has to say regarding Jim DeMint's question.
Well, first of all, it's not necessarily more spending. Appropriate tax relief would also help in the same way. But I've always said, and I said in my remarks, and I've said this a number of times, that you don't want to just do short-run stuff and ignore the long run. You don't want to just do long-run stuff and ignore the short run. You need a balanced program, one which at least avoids, I would say, you know, a do-no-harm policy is what I'm looking for here, at least avoids derailing the recovery in the short term, but combines that with a strong and credible plan for reducing the deficit over the medium term. I think that's the best policy. It may be very difficult to achieve, but that, in principle, that would be the best way to go.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You know, well, I will say this, at least Ben Bernanke is acknowledging the point that, you know, excessive government taxes is placing an excessive burden, I should say, on businesses and preventing economic growth to some degree. But I would go as far to say that it's the overregulation as well. And it's also the regime uncertainty in Washington, the fact that they're uncertain about what their taxes are going to be, what the regulations are going to be going forward. And, you know, there's also some uncertainty to what prices are going to be going forward. You know, the original intent of the Federal Reserve was to maintain price stability. We do not have price stability in this country. But I would go as far to say that price stability equals chaos. You never have price stability. But what suppliers are afraid of is, you know, inflation. They're you know, producers and job growers are afraid, you know, if you're manufacturing something, if the price of the raw materials that you're trying to acquire are costing you more, and you're, you know, you can anticipate to some degree price fluctuations as far as, you know, if the raw material supply is fluctuating, you can anticipate some change in supply or some change in the price of that raw material. But if price inflation, as far as monetary inflation comes into play, that throws a whole another monkey wrench into the type of analysis that you're trying to conduct as a business owner. Not only do you have to try to figure out what the supply is of the good that you're trying to buy, that you want to put together with other good raw materials to create, you know, consumer goods. Not only are you having to try to manage that and anticipate the price changes from that angle, you also have to anticipate what the government is doing and what the monetary policies of the Federal Reserve are going to do to those future prices. And so it's creating huge uncertainty in the marketplace, but also the fact that we are inflating to the point that we're inflating right now, you know, we're actually very lucky. You know, the new trade deficit numbers came out today. $53 billion, I believe, was the trade deficit for last month. So you're looking at $50 billion over a 12-month time frame. And so it's just, it's ridiculous. I mean, you're looking at, you know, roughly $630 billion, I don't know the exact number, $630 billion, well over a half a trillion dollars a year in the trade deficit, okay? So in a year's time, we are flooding the world market with $636 billion, $630 billion, $640 billion. I said 636 just to be halfway. Regardless, well over a half a trillion dollars that we're flooding the world market buying goods from overseas, and we're not producing anything here. We're not creating growth here. Okay, we're financing our consumption and our living standard through the trade deficit, and no one wants to talk about that. They don't want to talk about the fact that we are over-consuming in this country and we're not producing anything. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that the U.S. dollar is the world reserve currency. There are a lot of things that have to change monetarily from a world standard for the U.S. to regain its economic dominance and be and try to return itself to the largest creditor nation in the world instead of the largest debtor nation in the world. But the reality is the trade deficit is only making that problem worse. It's only making the job growth problem worse. At some point in time, we're going to have to face up to the fact that we have to start producing things again. We cannot continue to have a living standard beyond what our productive capacities as a nation are currently. So that's all I have for this edition of the Libertopian Podcast. As soon as that Peter Schiff video comes out that I want to comment on, I'm actually going to make another podcast and comment on that video. Until then, I'll see you guys later.